time to wrap down list week for 2022. And by list week, I mean list month, because I have uploaded so many videos that do not correspond in what we normalize as a week. While I think this is one of the greatest years for albums, in general, this isn't one of my favorite years for individual songs. I didn't really personally connect with the music like I've done last year or 2019, but still, that doesn't mean it wasn't fantastic as usual in the overall world of country, just that I've seen what I'm about to talk about in better ways before. So much of what we'll discuss here may or may not be familiar territory. Regardless, I've narrowed it down to 10 stellar tracks that I think represent the best country music had to offer. Some of it carries over some of my favorite albums, some of it doesn't. These two don't always correlate in the most narrow way possible, and like Grady said, this video is by far the most subjective and comes down to my individual tastes. So sorry if this video is too much of a downer for some people, I'm just built like that. But enough stalling to get this video to the appropriate video lengths, let's dive right in.
You two dipsticks ain't gonna last 10 seconds over the county line!
Picking the number 10 song every year is always a hard task, let me tell ya. You recognize early on what are easily your favorites, but then it comes down to where do you draw the line of elimination? And I had at least 7 songs in rotation that could have taken this spot. From Hummingbird, The Other Hummingbird, Mockingbird, Sad Bird, lots of bird songs this year, and I have no idea why. But I decided to go with the one that brought the most out of me, and that was Russell County Line by 49 Winchester. Hey, I love Appalachian music, sue me. While this is a very rustic and rugged song sonically, it's such a classy romantic song from its lyrics. Appalachian country easily makes the best love songs, from Lady May, Sorry for the Wait, and now this. Isaac Gibson gives a performance filled with passion as he builds in the verses to that incredible chorus he belts, promising his heart stays with his partner no matter the distance as he longs to return to the Russell County line. And oh my god, the climax of this song just shoots this song's quality up to the stratosphere. The epic guitar accompaniment, while a little tacked on, is still fantastic. This is just the complete package when it comes to love songs, and I couldn't have asked for anything better from this amazing group. I'm gonna leave a timestamp here for those who don't want to get into the topic of suicide, because I know it can be increasingly uncomfortable, so I don't want to force it onto others, so please go there if you wish. Anyways, Waking Up the Echoes by American Aquarium is probably one of the best songs I've ever seen handle the subject within country music, exploring every facet of dealing with loss, from the darkness of the aftermath to the reflection of the happy memories you shared, all while this lingering thought of what could have been different plagues your mind. What if they called? Maybe we could have talked them down. In the end, we can't do anything about it now. And the best we can do is cherish the memories we had with them. And in BJ Barham's case, it's these very cheeky lines of messing around a barbecue shack, or getting married to a Milwaukee girl. It's a song of many emotions, of grief, joy, denial, acceptance, all wrapped up in this touching package BJ Barham finally was able to tell after years of figuring out how to. If you have a similar story, this song will probably work for you, as I've heard it has for many people going through something like this. Easily one of his best written songs to date.
Let it die, let it die, let it shrivel up and come on, who's with me?
2022 was the year I fell in love with Molly Tuttle's music. It's kind of hard to believe this was the year she dabbled in the bluegrass, because she comes off as a natural on Crooked Tree, such a mystifying yet simple tale that, while seemingly complex about trees being cut down, is really about being yourself no matter how weird or quirky, and not to fall into a predictable line. A very relatable message presented in this incredible sense of grandeur, with fluid wordplay that rings exceedingly true for the world of bluegrass, progressing from realizing you're weird to being proud of that fact. You're not the same as everyone else, and that's the best possible thing. I don't have much else to add, except for it sounds incredible and Molly's voice is just perfect for a bluegrass setting. Definitely give it a listen, along with her incredible album I'll get to later.
The thing about classy is it's a state of mind.
Let me tell you. You do not understand classy country until you listen to Dance All Night Long by William Beckman. Such a glorious song, heavily inspired by the era of Marty Robbins, from the Latin influence to the horns, and just the sheer classiness presented in Beckman's voice and the story he tells. You truly don't get as country as this song was. It's not a story that's really meaty, and yet it feels as such with how well everything is presented. The immaculate voice range, the perfect amount of reverb giving off grandeur, to the impeccable instrumental palette Beckman uses on the song. His album was wildly inconsistent, but this was easily the song I came back to the most with how utterly rich it is. And ooh, what he starts singing in Spanish, oh my god, like, come on. How are you not listening to this song right now? I can't think of a single love song this year that even comes close to matching this level of romance, indie or otherwise. It's truly in a league of its own. Easily one of my most replayed songs of the year, and I can't get enough of it. Beckman is a newcomer, and songs like this are what I hope put him on the map.
Hunting, fishing, loving every day. That's the prayer that a country boy prays.
There were like 7 songs on White Trash Revelries that could have made it onto the list. Their album is one of the finest of the year, and I'll discuss it soon. But inevitably, I went with the song that truly hit the hardest for me personally. Middle of a Heart is Adeem's writing chops hitting their peak. A story of a person going from childhood, learning how to hunt, and putting a bullet through a deer with a rifle, to at least from my interpretation, watching the love of your life walk down the aisle for someone else, followed by joining the military in hopes of finding some future for yourself, only to be haunted by the actions you've committed, going from putting a bullet through an animal's heart, to feeling it through yours metaphorically, to putting it through human beings, to finally putting a real one through yours because you can't take it anymore. There's this lingering detail throughout the track of Adeem bringing things to the response of their mother, asking if they are proud of them in every portion told, to finally asking if they'll make it to heaven after all they've done in life. We don't know what they did, and it makes your imagination run wild. It's a song that gripped me from beginning to end and reminded me of classic Zac Brown Band ballads. There's definitely some more thought-provoking songs on Adeem's album, but this one by far stuck with me the most for its incredible progression of one of the most spectacular stories country has told all year. I don't normally put quote-unquote bangers in my songs of the year list, but every so often you find one that just hits home not only musically but emotionally. And Gabe Lee's Rusty is that one song. Similar to Cheap Seats in its story, all about trying to make it in the world, going at full force, running out of steam as time progresses, and you feel the time for your dream is running out. And the second verse especially hits home for me. That's totally me. All while you get one of the catchiest choruses all year, it reminds me of Morgan Wade a little bit, except done better, I will not compromise on that. It is incredibly rare when I want to blurt out a chorus at the top of my lungs. Most often, it's just me being quiet about it, but damn it, this one makes me want to belt. It isn't enough for a song to be musically a banger, but it's because of said incredible message that allows it to get this high. Maybe its message shot this one a few spots higher than it should have, but I don't care because it's easily my favorite Gabe Lee song. It's not as masterful as Eveline, but it is by far the one I connect to the most. I'm normally an alt country nut, but never to this extent before. Definitely spam this one, you won't regret it. Change by Big Thief is simply one of the greatest songs I've ever heard in my— wait, what? It came out last year? Oh well, Certainty, while not quite as flawless, is still one of the best— oh come on! Okay. Sparrow is easily one of my favorite pieces of Christian media. What the frick? What songs actually came out this year? Did Red Moon come out this year? It did? Okay, good. While most of my first choices from Big Thief's magnum opus came out last year, their material this year was also of exceedingly high quality. Red Moon is one of the few songs on here I'd classify as country music. Leave it to Big Thief's Adrian Lenker to make a simple visit to your grandma one of the richest stories country music has seen all year. Someone who isn't in the right headspace in life visiting the country to seek advice from their elder. And you're thinking, there's no way someone can make a story like that have as much quality to land in the top 5? But when you listen and read some of these lines, you realize that Adrienne is one of the greatest songwriters of our time. When I went through this song for the first time, I had to ask myself, how did they make this? How do you craft something of this lyrical value? Every line serving a purpose to weave such an incredible tapestry of ideas and themes, merging into this spectacular collective. It may not be my number one of the year, but it is by far the best rated country song I've heard all year, even outdoing Zach Bryan's writing, believe it or not. It's not number one because it's kind of messy, even if it is the point of the song, and the production feels a little too imbalanced despite it being excellent overall. But yeah, Big Thief rules, and I'm so glad they dabbled into country as minute as it was, and I hope they consider doing it more in the future.
Okay, so my transmission is shot, but I'm a talking car for crying out loud! Think what you're doing here!
I'm gonna be honest, Zach Mania has gotten out of hand. People seem to think Zach is a flawless artist and is unworthy of any sort of criticism, no matter how small it is. Zach Bryan is like any artist, capable of tremendous highs and lows. And it makes it so hard for newcomers to buy into the hype when fandoms put him on a ridiculously high pedestal and get aggressive when he doesn't meet people's expectations. And I'm sort of one of those people. But the one song, the song that absolutely reached those highs in my opinion, was 68 Fastback. Dare I say, this is the best song Zach Bryan has yet to do. I hesitate to call it his best written song, but I will say it is his best performed song. Because it's a flip of a coin whether or not you're gonna get a great performance from him. And with this one, he does it perfectly. This song just nails everything, expressing this bitterness, this resentment towards someone that we as a listener know isn't right, yet we can ultimately sympathize with it. With the incomprehensible amount of pain that is being expressed in both the delivery and the lyrics. I normally like my petty songs on the comedic side, but this one just captures that feeling near perfectly. Using this metaphor of him being like a car to a fantastic extent, calling what's left of him spare parts, and wanting to move faster than he ever has before, all while the full ensemble kicks in. Man, it's just perfect. I don't like hyping up Zach Bryan usually, but for this song, I will gladly do so because it is chock full of emotion. I still don't understand how this wasn't the ending to the musical portion of the album, but oh well. It's probably the only Zach Bryan song I'd give a rare 10 out of 10 to, even if he does have several amazing songs in his catalog. Not one is able to come together and deliver something of this magnitude the way 68 Fastback does. There's many songs from American Heartbreak you could choose from, but I decided to go with by far the most emotionally investing song Zach Bryan has sung yet.
There's gonna be love! So much, he's gonna drown in it!
Let Me Drown by Orville Peck kind of has an unfair advantage to it, in which every single song beforehand on Bronco enhances it when listened to in context. The themes of toxicity, the themes of water spread throughout the album all build to this moment, all carefully crafted to give this all the weight it should. Because by all means, it's the climax of Bronco. No song before or after is supposed to reach as high as this one does. And yeah, they don't. The only words that come to mind with this song is operatic and euphoric, as this man digs deep down to deliver an unquantifiable amount of pain. While Zach's pain was expressed in somber, this is truly unleashing everything and letting these bottled emotions all out. The string accompaniment is perfect and the writing cuts insanely deep, as I said, with everything building up to this moment. All while Orville gives the performance of his career and flexes like he's never done before. Maybe the piano is a little too basic given the level of everything else in this song, but that is an incredibly thin nitpick. In the end, this song is truly perfect. And at this point, you have to ask, if this song is number two, what in God's name is number one?
It's time for the moment you've been waiting for!
In a year with masterful songwriting, masterful themes, and awe-inspiring performances, not one song this year, in my opinion, was able to top Ian Noh's Ballad of a Retired Man. This song is truly everything. It's the best song Ian Noh has ever done in his entire career, and is the pinnacle of this man's unrivaled storytelling skills. telling the story of this blue-collar man seemingly being free from decades of strife only to be hit with a terminal illness, desperately trying to survive only to slowly give up as time goes by. The song's melody never changes, really capturing an endless cycle of perpetual despair and disappointment. You'd think the same melodic phrase would be dumb and it would get boring. But it never does, and that's not what this song is about. It's going through this one verse at a time as you're sucked into this story of a man who was dealt such a shitty hand in life. Every moment of this man's retirement spent expecting death to walk up to his doorstep. You get so many details, from initially believing he's just a simple working man to realizing he suffers PTSD from his experiences in Vietnam. Every detail bringing you deeper and deeper into the tragedy, all while Ian masterfully paces this story, allowing you to move along without the need to retread these things with something as trivial as a chorus. When I listen to this song, I genuinely forget I'm listening to music and just watching flashes of a person's life. Its storytelling is just that flawless. And as we near the end, while the music never accelerates in dramatic fashion, its story absolutely does, making the emotions soar higher and higher as he questions where he'll go after this. And you understand why, because of the detail of Vietnam. It's never addressed because there's no need to, as we piece it together ourselves. It's truly one of the most sensational country songs I've ever heard. Just listen to it, and you'll see why no other country song this year could have topped this list. It's absolutely the peak of country music this year, as far as I'm concerned. And I'd say, Ian Ngo's greatest artistic achievement.